given us the opportunity to be here to worship Him one more time.
Yeah.
To be able to spend time with each other in fellowship.
Yeah.
And I always think when I'm sitting there in the audience here, when we come to 16th and Noble, if you don't want to have a good time, don't come here. If you don't want to feel like you're at home, don't come here.
Yeah.
And if you don't want the truth, certainly don't come here. Amen.
Yeah.
So we're so glad that God's given us opportunity to be together one more time. I believe that God can be worshiped 24 hours, 7 days a week, sentimentally, in our heart, despite this being the formal assembly for worship. Because obviously there, I don't know about you, but when I'm on my job, I'm praying out to the Lord. Right? I'm on the road, so if I got road rash, Lord, help me. Come on now. I'm not serving the God, I know you serve the God. That's open 24 hours, 7 days a week for all of us. So if He's that way, I can praise Him 24 hours, 7 days a week. So we thank God again for allowing us to be here, but most of all, we're going to sacrifice on the cross. Without Jesus, we'd have no opportunity at eternal life. Again, I thank my wife for continued love and support of 22 years. I was reminiscing with some of the back, and some of y'all pulled me aside and started talking about what all this is on my face. My wife got in on it too, and we looked at Brother Glass, got to call him out for a minute. Said, are you two copying each other? I said, no, because we got another one over there look behind. I said, for some reason, it's this great beard season. I know what with that. But I'm just saying this, is that, you know, I thank God that God brought us down here in 2007.
Yeah.
We've been here. I was reminiscing with somebody again in the back. I've been here 17 years. I'm 25 pounds lighter. Black hair everywhere. I guess time takes its toll.
Yeah.
Over time. So I'm glad to be able to grow fat and grow gray. Amen. Because God don't let everybody do that. We don't thank God for that our right mind and our abilities that we have here today. But before getting the word of God, I definitely would not be right if I didn't give the church leadership here their kudos. And thank you for allowing me to be here today. And I've always, since the moment that I've met our brother and sister Jones, have really looked up to them. And I thank them for the kindness, the hospitality, and befriended us from day one.
Amen.
That we met them and treated us like their own children. Amen, y'all. And that's a good thing. You don't want everybody to treat you like a child. I want them to. That's fine. With me here today. But because of time, I don't want to delay us much further. Let's go to Matthew chapter number 9. I believe that God has a word in us for us collectively and individually, as well as we go through the word of Almighty God. Of course, the selected scripture was Matthew chapter 9, verse 1 to verse number 8. And of course, we want to make sure that we always study the Bible properly, so that's why we read all 8 verses. So I believe I can take the liberty and go on from verse 4 to verse 8. Because you've already got the context from all 8 verses. But when you have Matthew chapter 9, verse 4 to verse number 8, somebody say amen.
Amen.
The word of God, ushered from our Lord and Savior, says, but Jesus, knowing their thoughts, said, why do you think evil in your hearts? For which is easier to say, your sins are forgiven you, or to say, arise and walk? But that you may know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins. Then he said to the paralytic, arise, take up your bed and go to your house. And he arose and departed to his house. Now when the multitude saw it, they marveled and glorified God who had given such power to men. I want to share with us a subject this evening that I think has been hijacked from the Church of Christ.
Yeah.
If you notice, we have for many centuries battled denominational nonsense.
Yeah.
But also now, we're in another era in which there are other types of churches. If you are noticing the trends in so-called Christianity today, people are actually stepping away from denominations. And they're stepping into what they're calling non-denominations. Now, of course, the truth is not there. But the reason why I'm saying this is that we know that Satan can hijack some things that are really of God. He's hijacked words like sanctified. See, the first thing when you think about sanctified, you think about people foaming at the mouth and rolling on the ground. Sanctification means that you have been set aside for God. So if anybody's sanctified, it's the Church of Christ. Amen. If you want to take away the words and put it upon themselves in the words in Christ, I haven't seen nowhere we can get in Christ by praying about it. I haven't seen anywhere in the Word of God where you can just believe your way into Christ. Because my Bible says in Galatians 3 verse 27, those that have been baptized have been baptized into Christ. So with that introduction, this is what this topic is talking about here today, because it has been hijacked from those that don't have the truth, but it really belongs to us. I like to use that the analogy. If somebody stole your car and you got it, wouldn't you drive it in? Amen. So I'm here to reclaim something that really belongs to the Lord's church. And that being the awesome power of Jesus reassures me of my salvation. The awesome power of Jesus reassures me of my salvation. Remember, we serve the God that said, can't nobody pluck them out of my hand. That belongs to us. That don't belong to nobody else. Let me take you down memory lane for a minute. And from where I'm from, this is probably more relevant. Meaning that I've gone into the age in which some of my extended family have walked away from the church or will not come to the church because they have converted to Sunni Islam. Or they have gone to denominational sources as well. So this will make sense as we go along. See, there have been some very famous people in history that still have name recognition right now and started movements that lasted for centuries. Muhammad of the Islamic faith is one of them. Yes, Islam is a competing religion with Christianity that takes elements and steals from Judaism and Christianity in order to try to establish its own credibility, while at the same time contradicting thousands of years of God's word revealed to us in the Old Testament and New Testament revelation of God's will. See, the Quran, which is the holy book of Islam, is supposed to have been originally given by the angel Gabriel, who gave this word to Muhammad around 609 years after Jesus Christ. If I can be sarcastic for a minute, that's a little late, ain't it? Yeah. Amen. However, the Word of God said hundreds of years before Muhammad was born, in Galatians chapter 1, verse 8, verse number 9, but though we, or an angel, ain't that it? But though we, or an angel from heaven, preach any other gospel unto you, than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. It's like God had to keep saying it. Verse 9 says, as we said before, so I say now again, if any man preach any other gospel unto you than that ye have received, let him be accursed. You see, if you want to tell the truth about it, Islam is another gospel. And that's why there is no salvation in the Muslim faith. See, this brings us to the question then. What is the true gospel that saves, that Paul and the rest of the apostles taught? Romans chapter 10, verse 9, verse number 10. Which came from the mouth of Paul is good as a beginning can be. The Bible says, if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thy heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto what? Salvation. King James Version. But the Apostle Peter said, now we're trying to establish the true gospel. Is that all right, y'all? Yeah. We go down this path for a minute.
Word.
The Apostle Peter said in Acts chapter 2, verse 36, he says, therefore, let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God hath made that same Jesus whom ye have crucified, both Lord and Christ. Jesus said himself, now, if you understand what I'm doing here, I'm elevating authority here. Amen, y'all. We're going from the lowest to the highest. But let's take ourselves over to Jesus, who said in John chapter 14, verse number 6, he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. He said, no man cometh unto the Father but us by me. Amen, somebody. And I'm just silly enough to believe him. Amen. Anybody else believe that he's the only way, the truth, and the life? Even more, that same Jesus tells us, If we do not believe he's the Son of God, also known as the Lord and Savior, we're going to die in our sins.
Yeah.
See, John 3, verse 24 documents this firmly, where the Bible says, and this is Jesus speaking again, he said, I said therefore unto you, that ye shall die in your sins. For if you believe not that I am he, ye shall die in your sins. So Islam says that Jesus is none of these things. And I ask Muhammad, who gave you the call to say that? Because he speaks out differently than the Holy Spirit inspired words that Paul, Peter, and Jesus said about the Lord and Savior. His Islam must be false, because his foundation came from the wrong source.
All right, come on, God.
A supposed angel, and contradicting all of the revealed word of God that existed hundreds of thousands of years before their so-called prophet Muhammad, and proved very quickly that neither he or every lie he told came from the Lord.
Amen.
And even if an angel, even if an angel, you can't fall back on an angel.
Rely on.
You can't fall back on an angel.
Rely on.
And I believe he was lying on Gabriel. Gabriel was the one that came to Joseph. Amen. And said what? Don't you dare put away Mary. That woman, I'm paraphrasing, now she's been chased. Brother, can I really take you where we need to be?
Come on, God.
She ain't been running around on you, Joseph. Amen. Amen. Ain't nobody touched her. She's done nothing wrong. That was conceived in here is a miracle. That was the Gabriel I know. The Gabriel I know in the Bible, when you go take some man in the desert somewhere and tell him, oh, the Bible is corrupt, but let me give you something different. Amen. I think somebody lied on Gabriel. Amen. I think Gabriel would have been framed. Amen. He's been hoodwinked in vandalism. Amen. We can't allow him to drag a Gabriel's name through the mud. Amen. So even if, now I'm just going to say, okay, let's give him the benefit of the doubt. If Gabriel did give him the Quran, the so-called holy book of Islam, who told him he had the authority to do it? Amen. Because I still serve Jesus in Matthew 28, verse 18 and 20. All power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. My Bible tells me in the book of Hebrew that even the angels got to bow down to Jesus Christ. Amen. So I already know, even if they try to fall back on that, it can't be true anyway. See, all I got to do is know a little scriptures, and Islam will fall apart at its very seams from the very beginning. See, the Bible came from the Holy Spirit, who is God, and the Holy Spirit is appearing in himself above any angel any day of the week. So as you can see, Islam comes apart very quickly at its foundation. And because of how they receive the scriptures through supposedly an angel, we already know that it's not the word of Almighty God.
Yeah.
I'm not going to stay there. I just want to use that for a minute. And go back to Matthew chapter 9, verse 1. We see in Matthew chapter 9, verse 1 and verse number 8, we see the story of a paralyzed man that was brought to Jesus. Now, we see faith in action when this man was taken to Jesus. Amen, y'all. Because not only did the man have faith, but the people that brought him to Jesus had to have faith that Jesus could heal him. But what we miss in this story is the first part. See, we want to shout, we want to get happy about him being healed. That's not the good part of the story. The good part is the first part. Because what did Jesus do in the beginning? He says, your sins have been forgiven. Then he told the man, pick up your bed. Arise and walk. What is the scripture trying to tell you? The scripture is trying to tell you that God is more concerned with the spiritual than the physical. And so when that is the case, should we be more demanding about what? The spiritual in ourselves than it is what? The physical. Because if you don't know this by now, we're talking about all these gray beards in here. Y'all talk about how gray I am. You weren't gray when I was here either. When I first got here. So that means what? On all of us. Amen. I remember there's some people that are not present here, and I'm not making fun of them at all. But it used to be dying in the wool always at every first Sunday. But they can't die. Because their bodies are not cooperating with them. They understand.
understand the concept of what Paul said about the tabernacle. In other words, this body that you see, is this temporary? It's made to work out, wear out. But I'm so glad I got a building not made with hands. That's waiting on me. God got something permanent for us. God got that body waiting on us. 1 Corinthians chapter number 15, which I'm studying right now. That God is telling us it's going to go down like a seed, but it's going to rise something different. Amen. It's going to die in the ground, but it's going to rise to immortality. I don't know about you, but I'm ready. My wife's going to wound me already. I can't ever forget that. I can't ever remember to take my medicine like I should. I tell you the truth about that fact. But see, I don't want to be able to keep taking medicine. I want to throw that stuff out. One day, anybody want to get rid of their medicine? Yeah, amen. I know we got medical professionals being here loving you, but we don't want to stay in your office. Amen. Amen. I don't want to deal with your insurance companies. Amen. I don't want to deal with your co-pays no more. Amen. I don't want to be in them hard beds in the hospital. I don't care. Wait. But I don't want to see another casket. Amen. Huh? I want to be walking around the streets of gold. Amen. And pearly gates. That's the kind of stuff I want to do. And be able, I don't need no sleep. I don't need no rest. Amen. No pain. No sorrow. No more dying. Amen. I'm so tired of my eyes on the sparrow. I don't want to hear that stuff. No more. Amen. You understand what God has in store for you if you stay faithful to Jesus unto death. But let's go back to the story here. I've got a little track off track a little bit here now. Remember, the first thing that Jesus dealt with was the man's sins.
Amen.
His sins, the celebration point, was that he dealt with that before he healed the man. So again, the spiritual side should always come first for us. It's because all that's in this world, even ourselves, it's going to go away one day. However, the soul will live on. And this is what Jesus was targeting in the man first, and then he healed the man's body. If you notice, both of those were easy for the Lord. Oh, did you catch that? That's what he was really saying to them. He was really saying, which is easier for me to do? To say, your sins are forgiven, or arise your man to walk. See, what he was trying to show them is, I've given you some evidence of who I am. I'm showing you who the Son of God really is. And so only somebody that's the divine can, what, give you the forgiveness of your sins. Amen. See, I wish I would go to some Catholic confessional and hear him say, oh, your sins are forgiven. But what about you? What you going to say to me? Oh, man, I'm not good. How you going to tell me? Now, if you're going to tell me my sins are forgiven, let me find a paralyzed man somewhere. Bring him in here. I want you to say the same thing to him that Jesus did. Because if you got the authority over his sins, you better have the authority over his body too. Amen. Oh, y'all don't challenge folks like that. Y'all don't challenge folks like that. But see, we should be doing these types of things. You see, the thing is, like when somebody claims, like David Koresh used to be doing back in Waco, that he's the next Jesus. All right, show me. Let me go out there to the lake. Let me see you walk on water. Amen. Let me take you to the cemetery and tell somebody, get up off the grave like God did with Lazarus. Amen. Yeah. Let me die. We didn't go that far. Let me find somebody with a fever. And you can run out of him. Amen. Yeah. See, y'all don't want to challenge folks like that. Y'all just let folks gullibly lead you anyway. Don't do that. If they are claiming to have any power of Jesus, they have all the power of Jesus. Amen. Yeah. So obviously then, our priority in everything should be what? The spiritual. The spiritual. And both of them were easy for the Lord to do, right? So the miracle served a purpose. It was not to amaze the crowd, but to give them a sign that Jesus could really forgive sin because he was also able to forgive the body. Even more, all these things were used to make the people start believing that Jesus was and is the Son of God, Lord and Savior, sent from the Father to bless us with salvation. Jesus also forgave other people of their sins while he was alive before he was crucified in the form of the woman that washed his feet with her teeth and the thief on the cross, which you see in Luke chapter number 7 and Luke chapter number 3. Now, let's continue the thoughts regarding the deeds and miracles that Jesus did while still in the flesh and prior to his crucifixion. The Apostle John gives us a most profound statement. too much that he needed to catch her out in words. This John said, John 21, verse 25, it says, and there are also many other things that Jesus did, which if they were written one by one, I suppose that even the world itself could not contain the books that would be written. Amen. So like John, I can't give you every miracle that Jesus did, because there are too many to list in our hearing that are recorded in the Bible. But let's talk about some awesome power shown that no man in history, no man in our current era, no man in the future will ever be able to duplicate in one person like our Lord Jesus Christ. First, we know that Jesus turned water into wine. He healed Peter's mother-in-law of her fever. He gave the blind their sight. He allowed the mute to speak. He allowed the deaf to hear. He made the crippled walk again. He healed the lepers of leprosy. He healed the centurion servant from afar without even being there. And healed the man's servant. He cast out demons and the pigs that hurled themselves over a cliff. He told the winds and the waves, peace be still in the storm, and they had to obey his voice. He walked on water himself. Power flowed from him, from him just from the touch of the hem of his garments. He raised Jairus' daughter, the widow of Nain's son, and Lazarus from the dead. He was alive on earth after his resurrection for 40 days, teaching about the kingdom of God and seen by 500 people at one time in his resurrected form. He rose up into heaven, called his ascension into clouds, and will return to earth the same way from the clouds. Even while seated in heaven, the dying Stephen saw the risen Lord Jesus seated at the right hand of the Father in heaven. And even more, we know that he is alive because he spoke from heaven to the church persecuting Saul on his way to Damascus to persecute Christians, who eventually became the Apostle Paul, great evangelist and author of many of the books of those of the New Testament. Yes, Jesus has power unseen before in the world and never will be seen after him. So if he used the healing of a paralyzed man to show he is the Son of God, what more proof do you have for him to be your Lord and Savior? We should need nothing else. There's no reasonable doubt that Jesus is the Son of God. Don't harden your heart, because the evidence of his sonship is right in front of your eyes. This brings us back full circle to the title of the message today, being, before shortly closing out, the awesome power of Jesus reassures me of my salvation. Remember, Jesus is the good shepherd. And no one can take us out of his hand. No one can take our salvation from us. See, when we are Christians, because the power of Jesus prevents anything negative from happening to our souls when you are saved by the Lord and saved. See, again, we are eternally secure in the hands of the good shepherd, Jesus Christ. In fact, let's allow Jesus to close us out and let him explain himself. Let's look at John chapter 10, verse 23 and 30 that I'm reading in your hearing right now. Look what the Bible says about him. It says, and Jesus walked in the temple in Solomon's porch. Then came the Jews round about him and said unto him, how long dost thou make us to doubt? If thou be the Christ, tell us plainly. Jesus answered them, I told you, and ye believe not. The works that I do in my Father's name, they bear witness of me. But ye believe not, because ye are not of my sheep. As I said unto you, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. And I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. My Father which gave them me is greater than all, and no man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand. I and my Father are one. Again, that was John chapter 10, verse 23 and 30. As you can see, and Jesus tells us later in Matthew chapter 28, verse 18 and verse number 20, all power is in his hands. This is why we trust him, not only with our earthly existence and issues, but with the eternal salvation of our souls. God bless you. Thanks for listening. Genesis to Revelation,
God has been talking about Jesus coming, and in the New Testament he said he is here. When you look at the beginning, you look at Genesis chapter number 3, after man had originally sinned, God put a punishment on everybody, including Satan. But he also put a promise out there.
Yes.
Amen. From the very beginning, if you think about it, sometimes when you start something, you just want to tear it up and start again. Mm-hmm. Not God. I didn't understand, you know, back in the day, why did God just destroy Adam and Eve and just start again in the new world? Because he loved the world. It was right in front of my face. In John 3, verse number 16, because he said, "For God so loved the world." Mm-hmm. Think about what he just said. He loved a world that hates him.
Yeah.
He loved a world that rebelled from him.
Yes.
And still, he was able to say in John 3, verse number 16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life."
Yeah.
See, so at the very beginning, God was saying he wanted to send Jesus to save the world that had messed up from the very beginning. Amen.
Mm-hmm.
And then you keep going throughout the centuries, he keeps promising a Savior to come. One of the most famous ones is Isaiah 53, that he was bruised for our iniquity. The chastisement of our peace was laid upon him. In other words, he was saying that somebody special would come in the future from Isaiah's time. That person would be beaten and would die. But then God didn't leave him in the grave. Amen, y'all. The psalmist tells us in Psalm 16, verse 8, number 11, that he was going to get out of that grave. Amen, y'all.
Yeah.
You see, Jesus is the most important person that God has ever declared and has ever sent in this world. And he sent them for you and me. And on top of that, it wasn't like Jesus came reluctantly. In other words, he wanted to come here. Huh? Why? Because Jesus, when he was in the flesh, said, "Greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends." He was talking about himself. Amen. And Jesus also said, "If any man be my disciple, let him deny himself, pick up his cross, and follow me." What's the benefit? We talked about that. Jesus said, John 14, verse number 6, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father, but by me." But let me take you somewhere real popular. Everybody can say amen to that. I think they're Christian. But you can't always say amen in Matthew 16, verse 18. Because Jesus also said, "Thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against you." Amen, amen. God called his church an it, not a thing. And he put it upon us to find the it, and not find the one we want. Amen.
Amen.
See, it's interesting. We're very specific about everything but the church. We are.
Yeah.
We are. And I'm going to use a crude example. And hopefully I can come back here after I use this example. That is, all right. I live on a street that's 830 Brookhaven. That's my street address, right? I ain't giving you the rest because you might say, "I need that about that." Amen. I've been through that. I ain't going through that. No more. But you know what? At 8:30, Brookhaven has a wife there, right? The one I'm here. But if any house would do what any wife would do, can I go to 8:20? I can't go to 8:20, Brookhaven. I can't go to 8:40. A church is a church. A wife is a wife. It don't make any difference. What do you think Christ is talking about? He said, "I will build my church." And he said, and the church is the bride of Christ.
Yeah.
So Jesus is not going to run around from church to church to church to church. That makes for polygamous.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
So in other words, in order to find Christ, you got to find the right wife, which is the right church.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
The only way to do that is to do exactly what the ancient Bereans did in Acts chapter number 17. Even after the apostle called, a Holy Spirit inspired speaker, apostle, they still had the audacity, a good audacity, to study behind him to see if what he was teaching was the truth.
Right.
So let me challenge you with the truth here. And I do this not to be
encounter the truth is going to diagnose whether your heart is honest or not. When Jesus said you're going to stand at the door and knock, he said, don't harden your heart. The truth is knocking at your heart right now. What does the Bible, we talk about in here, what is the true gospel? The true gospel starts in Romans 10, verse 16. We're not used to that. It's talking about obeying the gospel. So that means you have to do something specific in order to be a part of the it. Matthew 16, verse number 18. Now we can work from Romans 10, 17. Well, the Bible says faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. The word of God has nothing to do with TJs. The word of God, if he in trouble, oh well. Anyway, I've been telling y'all for a long time. The word of God has nothing to do with George Meyer. The word of God has nothing to do with Joel Osteen. We go down by. The word of God has nothing to do with these churches calling themselves Baptist, Methodist, Presbyterian, nothing. You know why? Because you can't find them there. If you can't find them in the Bible, they aren't the it. They are the them. Amen. Remember, I used the analogy earlier about not being married. I got to go to the it. I can't go to the them. She wouldn't let me go with the them anyway. Amen. Not either. So don't be thinking that you're funny. Amen. I'm leaving with the itch. Amen. Right there. You get the point. You have to be very specific or you get yourself in trouble. Jesus said what? Matthew 7, verse 21. He knew this day was coming. He said, not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, so enter the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father, which is in heaven. Amen. See, I don't care what church you go to and all that kind of thing. We can't agree on one thing. That's in Romans 3, verse 23, Romans 6, verse 23. They all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. The wages of sin is death. The gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus. If you believe that Jesus is the Son of God, that promised Savior that God talked about in the Old Testament, and then you confirm that he's here in the New Testament, I commend you. I commend you. That's a radical and great step that you'll take. A lot of people cannot get there. But remember the rest. What did Jesus say? If any man be my disciple, let him deny himself, pick up his cross, and follow me. Me specifically. I'm talking about Jesus. So what else did he say for us to be saved? Now, hopefully you're getting out of your mind, you so-called reverends. You're getting out of your mind, you so-called pastors. Just think about what Jesus said. And Jesus only. Jesus also said about being saved. He said Luke 13, verse 3, verse number 5. He said, except ye repent, ye shall all likewise perish. He's the one that said it. We have to repent. Not me. Not no preacher, not no theology, no Bible college. He said that you have to repent to be saved. What's repentance? Repentance means what? Follow Jesus and leave a simple life alone. That's all it means. It means to take on a new lifestyle of being a Christian. That's what repentance means. Then after that, you must confess Jesus. Because why? Jesus said in Matthew 10, verse 32, he said, if you confess me before men, you will not confess before my Father. Which is in heaven. He said you have to confess before your Father. You know, I used this morning the example of Philip and the Ethiopian eunuch when it came to water. See, a lot of times we watch Joel Osteen and the rest of those folks up there that's doing this clowning and coonery and all that kind of nonsense that they're doing. When they got to that water, Philip and the Ethiopian eunuch didn't say, hey, here's water, let me pray. Lord Jesus, let me take you into my heart. I've been a sinner. I'm crying right now. And press you, Lord. No. What happened that chapter 8? The Ethiopian eunuch, after he was taught Isaiah 53, which I already told you, he said, here is water. What does it hinder me to be baptized? You see, there's a reason why the baptism is taught. Ethiopian eunuch would have been a Jewish convert. Right? Because why did he come to Jerusalem? He came to worship. Right? And so he would have immediately understood what baptism meant. Baptism to the Jews meant to what? And he would have been a proselyte as well. Right?
Yeah.
Do you know what they used to do with proselytes to elect the Jews? They baptized them. Baptism is not new. Because what they had to do when they were baptized to become a Jew was to wash out all the idolatry they had. And then they were, what they were doing, were confessing who their new leader was. So for the Jews at that time, when they were baptized, you know what they were confessing? I'm a servant of Moses, and I washed away the sins I did before I became a servant of Moses.
Reform.
And people study their Bible, they understand context. They understand why the change had to come, and why Jesus had to say now, in Mark 16, verse number 16, he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. He that believeth not shall be damned. What he was really saying is now you got to be baptized into me. And in order to be my disciple, you have to wash off the filth of sin like the Jews had to wash off of theirs before they became Moses' proselytes. That's why it was easy for those that were understanding of the Jewish faith to come out of it and know that you're being baptized so you become a disciple of somebody else.
Yeah.
So if you didn't go through that step, you were not that person's disciple. You were not their follower. This is why. We're taking one more place and I'm going to sit down. So you understand baptism. Remember, Jesus asked a question to the Pharisees. Remember, he asked this question. The Pharisees avoided the question because they knew what he was asking. He said, was John's baptism, was it of heaven or was it of men? What did the Pharisees step back and do? They said, I don't know. You know why? Because if they would have said it was of God, then Jesus would come back and say, why weren't you baptized by John? If they would have said no, the people would attack them because they knew that John the Baptist was a why do you think they were avoiding baptism? Because then they would have had to renounce all the lies they told people. They'd have to stop their hypocrisy. They'd have to stop their love of money because they were criminals. Amen. Religious cons is what they were. I taught the church this morning. So now, you understand the context of the Bible. Now it's time to get rid of the foolishness of what man teaches. If you want to become Jesus' disciple, there's no other way of doing it than getting in that water behind us. Because that's when you declare, I'm a follower of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
If you have not done that, you have not done it. If you have had somebody say, oh, I've been saved, you don't have to be baptized, they didn't lie to you. God did not send them. See, if y'all want to take it real ethically, you cannot be taught wrong and say right. See, the Bible says, I learned this from Brother Stairs. He said, the Bible says, one Lord, one faith, one baptism. Do you know what the one baptism actually is? It's not that, oh, I've been baptized in the Baptist church, I'm good everywhere. It's not that I've been baptized as a Methodist, I'm good, or a Lutheran. What that's saying is that there's only one baptism that puts you in Jesus Christ.
Amen.
So if you have not been taught his doctrine and his doctrine put fully, you have not had the one baptism. You have been baptized, made wet, and lied to. Amen. That's all it is. I ain't trying to hurt you. I'm just trying to show you the truth. Again, this is an honesty check on your heart right now. If you really love the Lord, you'll love him more than you've ever been taught anything bad in your life. You'll love him more than tradition. You'll love him more than father and mother. You will come down that aisle, give your confession, and won't nobody stop you.
Yes, sir.
Many of you probably seen on Facebook that we have a new sister in Christ. She stumbled down God.
Amen.
Because she had back problems. She's on a walker, all those type of things. But she came out of the audience by herself. Because she understood the word of God. She was honest. She was honest. It took us 4 hours to baptize her. I believe I could, like they say at my job, I believe I could volunteer him. In other words, if we take us 6 hours to baptize him, we'll stay right here. Amen. Amen. And we'll get it done because we know how important that is. It's more important than a life in your lungs. The breath in your lungs right now. Because we're talking about eternity. So after you come out of that water grave baptism, see, you and the church need to rejoice. Amen. I remember that, and y'all probably don't get mad at me, but I remember down in St. Louis, and a man got baptized under the audience, and the congregation was celebrating and all that good stuff. And then the preacher got up, "What are y'all doing?" I should have got up and said, "What you doing?" I was just being nice. I was a visitor. Yeah. I should have challenged him. I was wrong. I should have challenged him. Because if the angels rejoice, when one sinner repent, I got the reason to rejoice. Yeah. Somebody come out of that watery grave of baptism. That's what we're going to do here. That's what we're going to do. Because we know you had to overcome something. That you might have been fighting your own heart to get here. But your love of God is what you want. More than anything else. But I do have the encouragement. Out of the water grave baptism, we got to stay in the inch. We got to stay in the church. So Jesus talking about Revelation 2 verse 10, be thou faithful unto death, and I will give thee a crown of life. If by chance you're a Christian that's fallen short, it's time to get back in the inch. Because you can sit in the building and not be in the inch. Amen. If your heart is not in God, you ain't living right. It's time for you also to repent. Because you called and ask God to forgive you. Acts 8:22. And God will accept you just like he did with the prodigal son. Remember, he wasn't mad at the prodigal son. He was glad. Because why? His son was dead, but now he's not. He was lost, but now he's fine. We're going to hand things back over. Now my brother can come over. I told you I need you.